घटम चारुतुर्भिश्चतुर्भिः सूक्ष्म स्वच्छादिरुद्यम शुकपरिविलसन् मौलिमं भोजनेत्रम् कालाम्बुदोज्ज्वलाङ्गं कटितटविलसत् चारुपीताम्बराढ्यं वन्दे दन्वन्तरिन्तं निखिलगदमिव प्रौढदावाग्निनीलम्
Namaskar to all of you. Today, our continuation in the series of the clinical discussion series, Role of Daivyapashray Chikitsa in Agantuch Roga, based on the reference of Brihadri. This is a lecture which is exclusively presented by Professor Raghavinder Udupa. He is a professor and head department of Samhita and Siddhanta, Yanopia Ayurveda College, Mangalore. I hope that he will join within a minutes. And this is a very good lecture. I hope that the basic principles of Ayurveda will be clarified more and more through these lectures, which we are planning in our Ayush Darpan. And Ayush Darpan is also a platform where the East, West, South, North, all the experts are coming here to share their experience. So I welcome to Dr. Raghavendra Udupa. I hope that he is just joining. Welcome, sir. And continuation of the series of the lectures in regularly Sunday at 6 p.m. Previously, you already attended the three lectures of Professor Raghavendra Udupa. This session is also very important. I welcome to Professor Udupa for your presentation here, sir. Aapko bahut bahut namaskar. Aapka time se humne session start ho gaya. I am just making you a co-host as well as I am allowing the share screen. So that's why you can share your screen also. It's a Sunday special session and you can interact with Professor Udupa also. Aap unse sawalat bhi kar sakte hain. Hamara ye prayas hai ki variations aapko mile. Hamare Bharat mein vidwanon ki kami nahi hai. दक्षिण हो, पश्चिम हो, उत्तर हो, पूरब हो, हर जगह विद्वान है. हमें हर विद्वान से ज्ञान लेना है. हमारा उद्देश्य क्या है? ओनली नॉलेज शेयरिंग. तो आइए, हमारे साथ बहुत सारे लोग जुड़ गए हैं सर. यहाँ पे के एन गंगवार जी हैं, विष्णु कुमार पांचाल जी हैं, विजु पाटिल जी हैं, कुसुम जी हैं, पंकज भारद्वाज जी हैं, विकास जी हैं, रवि जी हैं, सहाना जी हैं, प्रियदर्शिनी जी हैं, गरिमा जी हैं. बहुत सारे लोग जुड़ गए हैं. बहुत 21 लोग जुड़ चुके हैं. Can you unmute yourself? Just unmute yourself. Yeah. Unmute yourself, sir. Yes, yes. Now, okay, sir. So now you can start. I have just introduced you. Professor Raghavendra Udupa is from Yanopa Ayurveda College. He's a professor and HOD of basic principle. As you all know, he already presented his two continuous lectures in this platform. So I welcome you, sir.
Should I share the screen?
Yeah, you can share.
Okay. Yeah. Good evening, everybody. We will continue the topic what we have discussed in the last two sessions. I hope you remember the points what I have discussed in the last class. In the last class, just within a few seconds, I'll summarize the thing what I have discussed. In the last class, what I discussed is about the thing which is important for the diagnosis, how to understand a disease, whether it is a Nijavyadhi or Agantavyadhi, and how to differentiate in terms of the share screen. Yeah, now it is. I hope all of you can see this screen now.
Yes, sir. You can make it full screen, sir.
Right. Yeah, full screen it's done now. Yeah. Nija Vyadi and Agantu Vyadi, how the Doshik theory is having some limitation in the clinical practice, though we are dependent mainly on the Dosha theory or Tridosha Siddhanta. In some areas, we cannot understand, we cannot see the things of the Dosha theory and its impact in terms of Chikitsa. So the Agantu factors, what are the Agantu factors I have discussed? Bhuta, Visha, Vayu, Agni, and Samprahara. And how we can manage in the clinical practice. As I'm practicing in Udupi, most of the time, around 50% of the patients, they are exhibiting the features of Agantu Rogas. So how the Daivapashra Chikitsa is helpful? And what are the Daivapashra Chikitsa? What I'm following, I'll discuss in the next class. But how, what is the role and how to understand the role of Daivapashra Chikitsa in Agantu Roga? That will be discussed here with a small clinical case in the end. So we will continue the talk. So as I told in the last class, Agantu Roga, it is nothing but produced due to Bhuta Sambhava. Bhuta Sambhava means unknown spirits or evil spirits, what we can call it as Pishachadayaha. In Sushruta Samhita, there are 8, starting from Deva, then Asura, then Gandharva, then Naga, Yaksha, Pitra, Rakshasa, and Pishacha. So that is totally called Pishachadayaha. So totally they are 8 in number in Sushruta Samhita and in Ashtanga Hrudaya. And if you see the Vastu text, or if you refer Vastu text, these 8 Bhutas or Pishachadaya, they represent the 8 directions, or what we can call it as the negative energy, which comes in different direction of a particular place or place of residence or place where person is living. So it represents the 8 direction of a house or a place of living. So the east direction, it represents Deva. That's why Devonmatta it is explained. And southeast direction, it is called Asura Graha or the place of Asura Graha. And east, south direction, it is Gandharva or the place of Gandharva Graha. And south-west direction or Nairitya Dik, that is representing the Yaksha Graha. And west direction, it represents Pitra Graha. And northwest represents Naga Graha. And north direction, it represents Rakshasa Graha. And northeast, it represents Pishachi or Pishacha Graha. So in this way, there are 8 directions, and in 8 directions, there will be a negative energy which comes or which enters into human body or which enters into the house. So that is called Bhuta Sambhava or Pishachadayaha. Then Visha Sambhava, explanation or a clinical case I have discussed in the last class, the Visha Sambhava, how a Visha or Gara Visha or any other Visha can produce a disorder and how we have to manage. Then Vayu Sambhava, that is discussed a short in the previous class, that is the Visha Vayu that represents the Agantu factor in the form of Vayu. And Agni Sambhava, the anything which is caused due to fire, then it is called Agni Sambhava. Then Samprahara, Samprahara means hitting or falling or injury, those things are called Samprahara Adi Sambhava. This is in Charaka Sutra, 7th chapter. And Chakrapani says, Adi Grahanat, Pata Bandhanadinam Grahanam. So Adi means the fall or tying, all these things, they are considered as Adi. That is Pata Bandhanadinam Grahanam. There are few more things, so which is explained in the text, that we will going to see what are the other causes of Agantu factor. Agantu Roga Karanani, if you see the Agantu Roga causes in Charaka Sutra, 20th chapter, that is Maharoga Adhyaya, which explains about the link between the Hetu and the Lakshanas in a human body. And here telling while telling about agantaroga karanani, word karana is not explained. It is mentioned as agantaroga mukhani. So here mukha means it is mukhya karana or pradhana karana. So agantaroga karanani means agantaroga pradhana karanani or agantaroga mukhya karanani. So many things are explained in the form of a list. So I am going with the list which is explained in Charaka Sutra 20th chapter, 4th shloka. The first one is Nakhadashanam, that is the nail and the teeth of animals or the reptiles. So this is considered as Agantukarana, something in the form of bite. For example, snake bite or Nakha or the nail of an animal which is causing some injury to the body. These are considered as Agantukarana. Then patana. Patana means fall from a height where you will be susceptible for some injury in the form of fracture or dislocation. That is also considered as agantaroga karana. Then the four causes which are explained are very important for the clinical practice. The first one is abhichara, then abhishapa, then abhishanga, then abhighatam. All these four words are starting with the prefix as abhi. Abhi means it is like throughout. So that is abhichara, abhishapa, abhishanga, and abhighatam. So these are explained as causative factor as agantukarana. Then vyadha. Vyadha means pricking with a sharp instrument or pricking with a needle. That is also called vyadha. Bandhana, that is you are encircled or you are tied with certain thing like rope, etc. Then that is called bandhana, which is again considered as cause for agantaroga. And vestana, again it is a form of wrapping. Pidana, that is the squeezing something from the external force. If body is squeezed, then that is called pidana. Rajudahana, like the tying the thread around the body, and if it is burnt, then that is called rajudahana. Then shastra, using sharp instruments. If body is injured by somebody else, then that is called shastra. Then ashani. Ashani means it is a thunderbolt. During rainy season, we have thunderbolts that is called ashani. And bhutopasargadini. Bhuta upasarga means the amanusha upasarga. That is also called amanusha upasarga. The thing which is not considered as manusha or human, and such energies are entering into the body, then that is called amanusha upasarga or bhuta upasargadini. So these are considered as agantu karanani or agantu mukhani. So this is nothing but the few more addition to the list which is given in Charaka Sutra 7th chapter. Here some more things are explained, and we will see how it is possible or what are the things which are listed here. Is it possible to identify these things even today? So that is the thing. And if you see the list, if it is given in this particular context, you can see Dvivida Roga Punaha. It is explained in Charaka Samhita, Sutrasthana 20th chapter.
There are your client, yeah? Is stuck, sir. Please, client okay, okay. Stuck over here, sir.
Okay. Now it is okay. Just a minute.
No, sir. Your slide is not moving, sir. It's not. Yes. Now it's okay, sir.
Okay. So there are two types of.
Slightly reduce, sir. Size reduce. Slightly okay. Reduce the size, sir.
Okay.
So it is
okay.
Out of the screen, sir.
Okay. Now it's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So okay. Dvivida roga. Like there are two types of roga based on roga prakriti or roga swabhava, and that is called nija agantu vibhagat. The types of disorder, it is two in number, that is nija roga and agantu roga. We have discussed earlier several times, and there are two causative factors. One is called mukhani, that is vyadhi mukhani and vyadhi prerakam. So vyadhi mukhani means it is pradhana karana or mukhya karana. And preranam means it is a stimulating factor. And in the list, the previous list, whatever I have discussed, that is agantu roga mukhani, these are the mukhya karana for agantu roga. And it is added with, or it is stimulated, or it is enhanced with some of the preraka karana, that is asatma indriyartha sanyoga, prajnaparada and parinamaham. So it is explained in charaka sharira what is asatma indriyartha sanyoga, prajnaparada and parinama, and it has been discussed in charaka samhita several times. We will not going to discuss, and the main out of these three, prajnaparada is considered as the main cause for asatma indriyartha sanyoga and parinama also. If you see charaka samhita sutra sthana 28th chapter, it explains prajnaparada hi ahitan arthan pancha nishevate. Because of prajnaparada only the person is consuming, or person is following asatma indriyartha sanyoga. And in charaka vimana sthana 3rd chapter, in the janapradodvamsaniya vijnaniya, there also the parinama or kala, which is disturbed in the universe because of prajnaparada. There it is mentioned prajnaparada mula eva. So the main or middle portion, that is prajnaparada, is considered as the important preraka for nija karan, nija vyadi and agantu vyadi. Though there is mukhya karana, the disease will be manifesting when there is trini ayatanani for disorder, whether it is nija roga or agantu roga. And out of trini ayatanani, prajnaparada is considered as important stimulating factor or enhancing factor. So what is prajnaparada? We have studied the definition, we have by hearted the definition, dhidrati smrati vibhramsta, etc. in the UG and PG level. But if you see charaka sharira, first chapter, Patidha Purushiya Adhyaya, there he has given the list of the acts which are considered as prajnaparada, out of which Vega Dharana is a prajnaparada, Vega Udirana, that is also prajnaparada, then Akala Desha Sancharam, untimely roaming in a place, then that is also prajnaparada, then Jnatva Swayam Arthanam Ahitanam Nishevanam, you know certain things are not good for health, but still you are consuming, means that is also prajnaparada. And Indriyopakramaniya Sadvratyasya Varjanam, whatever the sadvratta which is explained in Indriyopakramaniya Adhyaya of Charaka Sutrasthana 8th chapter, if it is not followed, then that is called prajnaparada. Then Esya, Mana, Madha, Krodha, etc. If person is indulging in those mental factors too much, then that is also called prajnaparada. So you just go through the list which is given in Charaka Sharira 1st chapter about prajnaparada. And in the society, in the present context, we are, or the patients are following these prajnaparada. No, they know that is not good for health, but they are consuming. For example, the smoking in the form of BD or cigarette, they know that it is not good for health, but still they are practicing that, then that is called prajnaparada. Then certain things which cause mada, then param avanmadikanam sevanam, that is the thing which is in the form of drug, if it is consumed, then that is called prajnaparada. You can see such causes even today in the society. And because of these enhancing factor or propagating factor, then there will be agantu roga or nija roga. And this is very specific for agantu roga, because though there is pradhana karana, if the sattva of a person is very good, then the disease will not be manifested, or the disease will be manifested with a little symptom as agantu vikara. If he is having heena sattva, then disease will be seen with the full symptoms. So that is the idea how you have to differentiate what are the mukha or mukhya karana and what are the preraka karana. So identify mukhya karana first, then see the whether there is any association of prerana karana or preraka karana, and then you can assume this is the thing which is going to happen or which is exhibited by this particular patient. That's what I have explained, the nimitta or karana. It is for nija vyadi, it is vata pitta shleshma vaishamya, as told in charaka sutra 20th chapter. For agantu karana, for agantu roga, there are like many, that is nakha, dashana, abhishaga, abhishapa, abhishanga, abhichara, etc. And in agantu karana, then mukha and prerana, you have to consider what is the mukhya karana and what is the preraka karana, and then the swabhava of agantaruga or vikara prakriti can be assessed. What is vikara prakriti or how it should be assessed, that we have seen in the previous classes. What is vikara prakriti, adhisthana antara and samutthana vishesha as told in the charaka. So agantaruga prakriti should be assessed and then you can treat it. Then as I told, the agantumukha, there are many in the list which is explained previously. The first two are nakha dashana and you just add shastra with that. Then if you refer Sushruta Samhita, Sutrasthana, Vyadi Samuddeshi Adhyaya, then there is a type or a classification of disorder which is called Sanghata Bala Pravritta Vyadi. And what is Sanghata Bala Pravritta Vyadi? He has explained Durbalasya Balavat Vigrahat Agantavu, that is a person who is having Balahinata or Durbala, a person who is weak, he is quarreling or fighting with a strong person, that is Balavat Vigrahat. So if a weak person, if he is fighting or quarreling with a strong person, then the Sanghata Bala Pravritta Bala Vyadi will be going to manifest. Here there is Preraka Karana and there is Mukhya Karana also. And Mukhya Karana is explained in the same context in Sushruta as Shastra Karana and Shastrakrata and Vyalakrata. You can see in the slide in the bottom, that is Shastra Teshcha Punashcha Dvivida Shastrakrata Vyalakrata. It is explained like that. Shastrakrata means the strong person with the weapon, he is going to hit you or harm you. That is Shastrakrata. Vyalakrata means if an animal like tiger or any wild animal, which is obviously stronger than you, when it attacks you, then you will be sufferer. That is Durbalasya Balahat Vigrahat. So here Mukhya Karana is Shastrakrata as told in the top of this particular slide. And Vyalakrata, Vyalakrata means the wild animals like tiger, etc., where Nakha, Dashana, etc. are coming to act. So this is called Mukhya Karana. And what is stimulating factor? Stimulating factor, it is Prajnaparada. That is a weak person, he knows that he is not so strong as the opponent, but still he is going to quarrel with the opponent. Then there will be a disorder or he will be harmed. So this is known as Sanghata Bala Pravritta Vyadi. And similarly, in the same context of Vyadi Samudeshi Adhyaya of Sushruta Samhita, we have to see. And in the list of Charaka Sutra, 20th chapter, there are two words. One is Ashani and Bhutopasarga. That list has already given, already displayed. And these two, that is thunderbolts and or lightning, and the Bhutopasarga or Amanushopasarga, they are coming under Dayobala Pravritta Vyadi of Sushruta Samhita, which says Dayobala Pravritta Ye Dvividaha Vidyut Dashanikrata Pishachadikrataha. The list is very long. I have not explained everything in Dayobala Pravritta Vyadi, but in that particular context of Dayobala Pravritta Vyadi, there are two types of disorder. One is Vidyut Ashanikrata and Pishachadikrataha. Pishachadikrata means the disorders produced due to Bhuta Upasarga or Amanusha Upasarga. Vidyudashanikrata means a disorder produced due to lightning or thunderbolt. And you may ask how a lightning will cause disorder to a person. I saw two patients suffering from pain or severe headache, which is produced after experiencing the current from lightning. So in a rainy season, here in place like Udupi, you will be expecting lightning quite often. And these two patients in different years, one is suffering since last 10 years and they're suffering from last 15 years. Both, they are suffering from severe headache, which is produced or which is experienced after an attack of electric shock from lightning. It's not like so severe attack of lightning. They were near to the source of lightning, and on that particular moment, they have experienced a headache, and till now, they are feeling that headache. It is similar like Tridoshaja Shiroroga, which is explained in Charaka Samhita, and they are not responding to the conventional treatment of Yukti Apashra Chikitsa. Even I have given the treatment of Yukti Apashra Chikitsa for the headaches which is produced due to Vidyut Ashanikratam. And you may ask, what is the Daiva Apashra Chikitsa for this particular treatment? Here in Udupi and almost all parts of the southern belt of Karnataka, there is a Shanti Karma, or there is a ritual which is called Vidyut Shanti. Vidyut Shanti means it is a puja where the Lord Indra is praised. Lord Indra is considered as the god or controller of Vidyut and Ashani. He will be praised with the mantras of Rigveda, and the Homa will be performed. That is called Vidyut Shanti. And for one person, I told you, just perform Vidyut Shanti and then we will give medicine. Then he performed at Vidyut Shanti, and after that the medicines were given, and after that the intensity of headache, it was reduced, and the medicine is continued for 6 more months, then the headache is completely absent. So this is how, whenever there is no result from Yukti Apashra Chikitsa, you have to think about Daiva Apashra Chikitsa if there is a cause in the form of Agantu Karana or Agantu Mukha, just like the Ashani or the Bhuta Upasarga, etc. So, but in clinical practice, we are not taking the Vidyut or Ashani as causative factor for a disease, but you can elicit or you can find out these causes in some patients. Usually the farmers who are working in the fields, they usually experiencing the attack or mild attack of lightning in one or other day of their life, and they say that after that they are not getting proper sleep, or they are not having some problem, or so they are having some problem in the form of illness. So these things you have to see in the clinical practice. Similarly, the Pishachadikrata or Amanusha Upasarga or Bhuta Upasarga, though you cannot see them directly, and you assume that these things are there, as told in Charaka Samhita, Pratyaksham hi Alpam, Analpam Apratyaksham Asti. That is, the direct perceptions, it is very minimum in this world, and indirect perceptions are maximum. That's why you have to believe in this particular statement of Charaka Samhita, that the thing which is not perceived by this particular sense organs of an ordinary man, it is maximum, then you have to believe that there are, or there is existence of the negative energy in the form of Pishacha, Yaksha, etc. And if you believe and if you practice based on the proper diagnosis, then you can treat Pishachadikrata also. So this is one Agantaroga, Mukhya Karana or Pradhana Karana, you have to see. Then there are some other Karanas or causes which are considered as Agantaroga Mukhani. The first one is, as I told, there are 4, Abhichara, Abhishapa, Abhishanga and Abhigata. In Charaka Samhita, in few contexts, these 4 contexts are explained together as the causative factor. The best example which we can understand these 4 causative factors together, it is in the context of Jwara Chikitsa. That is, in Charaka Samhita, Chikitsa Sthana, 3rd chapter, these causes are explained as the causes of Agantu Jwara. And you may ask, why this particular context of Jwara will be explained here? As you know, the Jwara is a synonym of Vyadhi. If you see Charaka Samhita Nidhana Sthana, 1st chapter, it is mentioned, Tatra Vyadiramayo Gadadanko Yakshma Jwaro Roga Iti Anarthantram. So Jwara, it is a synonym of various disorders. So it is explained in Jwara Chikitsa, doesn't mean that only Jwara will be explained there. It may be connected to some other causative factors which are explained, or which are connected to that particular. Am I audible now? Yeah, connected.
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Slides are not, I think slides are not coming.
Slides are not visible.
Okay. Just I'll do that. So these four causative factors, they are not only for Jwara, they are also for some other.
You can reshare it.
Okay. Reshare. Okay. Just a minute. Share. Okay. Somebody's sharing the screen. That's why I think that's the problem.
One minute. So just share your screen. Somebody's, please don't share others. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
ये आपका स्क्रीन नहीं है सर ये?
No, it's not my screen. It's somebody is sharing with the, some other screen.
Who is sharing? Why?
Okay. Now I'll share. Yeah, it's there now. So it's not my.
Please, one minute. Somebody is coming from the outside.
Yeah.
And Shara, who is Shara? Shara, why you are sharing screen? Who are you? I'm just removing you. Just now share it. Somebody, okay. I think stranger is joining the. Session okay. And he is doing some. Yeah.
Okay.
Just yeah. Share now. Share.
Yeah. I think now it's. Now it's okay. I think. Yeah. Now can you see this screen?
Yeah. Now it's okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah. There are four: abhichara, abhishapa, abhishanga, and abhigata. It is not only for Jwara, it is also for other disorders which are explained in Charaka Samhita, though it is explained for Jwara. And you have to interpret with the Hetvartha Tantra Yukti. That is, thing explained in one context should be applied to the other context also, in the form of Jwara as Vyadi Pariyaya. For all other disorders also, these Abhichara, Abhishapa, Abhishanga, and Abhigata causative factors or Agantaroga Mukhani should be applied. If you see Ashtanga Sangraha, Nidanasthana, second chapter, while explaining Agantu Roga Mukha as Abhichara, Abhishapa, Abhishanga, and Abhigata, the Hindu has commented that these four are not only for Jwara, it is for all other disorders, or Agantu Jwara Roga Mukhani should be interpreted as Agantu Roga Mukhani. So it is not for Jwara, not only for Jwara, it is for all other disorders which are coming in the clinical practice. Here it is mentioned Agantuhu Ashtamo Yastu Sanirdishtaha Chaturvidaha. There are four positive factors for Agantu Vyadhi or Agantu Jwara, Abhigata, Abhishangabhyam, Abhichara, Abhishapataha. So there are four, and it is that is applicable for all other disorders which are seen or which can be seen in the clinical practice. And continuing that with the Agantu Roga Mukha, we have to see the first one is Abhighata. Abhighata, it's already explained, that is Shastra Loshta Kasha Kashtra Musti Arantni Taladvijaihi Tatvideshcha Hate Gatri Jurahasyat Abhighata Jaha. That is any form of the external force in the form of weapons, that is Shastra. Loshta means it is in the form of the round ball. Kasha, it is a rope prepared out of cloth, that is called kasha. Kashta, that is stick, is used. Musti, that is fist, that is used. Aratni is, it is the forearm. And tala, aratni tala, that is the base of the aratni, that is used. Dvija is danta or tooth. These things are coming into the action in the Abhigataja Vyadi or Samprahara-adi Vyadi. And when the person is injured with such form of agantu karana, there will be jwara, that is gatre jwarah syat abhigata jaha. So it is applicable for other thing also. Then the next is abhishangaja jwara. there are three types of Abhishanga Jajwara. One is Kamadi Shanga or Kamadi Sanga, then Bhuta Abhishanga and Visha Abhishanga. In the Charaka Chikisa Sthana, third chapter, while explaining Abhishanga, there are three causative factors. And Kamadi Abhishanga means the person is suffering from certain things in the form of the mental factors like Kama, Shoka, Bhaya, Krodaihi. Even in the list of Prajnaparada, these mental factors are explained as causative factor as Prajnaparada. As I told in the beginning, if there is Preraka Karana only, then there will be manifestation of Nija Vyadhi or Agantu Vyadhi. So here, Kamadi Abhishanga means the person is inflicted with any of the mental factor which is beyond normal. Here, the normalcy is not considered here. If it is beyond normal, then that is called Kamadi Abhishanga Jwara or Kamadi Abhishanga Roga. That also you should consider in the clinical practice. Sometimes a person or a student who got only 80% in the 12th or 12th class, he is having some form of behavioral changes or abnormalities. Then if you ask him carefully, then he may say, I have not done my papers. I have not done my examination as expected by my parents. They were expecting around 95% and I got only 80%. That is disturbing me. That's why I am doing such behaviors. So such things are also there in the clinical practice, which you have to interpret in the, or which you have to take in the diagnosis of Kamadi Abhishanga. Nowadays, too much of attachment or too much of addiction with the cell phone, that is also considered in the Kamadi Abhishanga. The person is more and more attached to the cell phone, which is called nemomania, that is too much of addiction to cell phone. So such things are considered under the Kamadi Abhishanga. So Kamadi Abhishanga, you have to take it or you have to consider it. And after Kamadi Abhishanga, then there is a thing which is called Bhuta Abhishanga. As I told, that is Amanusha Upasarga or that what we call Pishachadi Krita Vyadi.
Kindly share the screen, sir.
Okay. Bhuta Abhishanga Jajwara, that is the second variety of Abhishanga Jajwara. And if you see the Charaka Samhita reference about Bhuta Abhishanga Jajwara, then there is a reference in Bhuta Abhishanga Jajwara in Charaka Samhita Chikitsa Sthana third chapter, which says about the references or the which says about which explains about Bhuta Abhishanga Jajwara. It says Bhutabhishangat Trayo Malaha Kupyanti. Because of the affliction with the Bhutas or the Agantu factors or evil spirit, there will be an involvement or aggravation of three malas. Bhutabhishangat Trayo Malaha Kupyanti Bhuta Samanya Lakshanaham. That is, because of Bhutabhishanga, the person is showing Amanusha activities or person is showing some abnormal activities in terms of bhutonmada, like how you have to understand bhutadikare vyakhyatam tat ashtavidham lakshanam. In bhutadikara or in bhutavidya chikitsa of Sushruta Samhita and in Ashtangaradaya, there is ashtavida lakshana. Ashtavida lakshana means like devagraha, asuragraha, gandharvagraha, as I told in the beginning. So there are 18 number. But as per Charaka Samhita, in the Chikitsa Sthana, ninth chapter of Chikitsa Sthana, it is around 18 types. The Graha Rogas are 18 in number, but according to Sushruta and according to Ashtanga, they are 18 number. That is Bhutadikare Vyakhyatam Tat Ashtavida Lakshanam. The 8 types of Grahas, like the Devon, Mada, etc. should be considered here. And third variety of Abhishanga Jajwara, where the body is considered.
1 minute, sir.
Okay.
आपके वाकई इस लेक्चर में जो है वो कुछ भूत प्रवृत्ति के लोग पता नहीं कहाँ से आ गए हैं जो बार बार यहाँ पर एनोटेशन डाल रहे हैं, और वो जबकि वो बाहर के हैं, कहीं विदेशों से हैं, वो मैं उनको रिमूव कर रहा हूँ सर। अब आप शेयर करिए सर।
Abhi, now you can see, I think. Yeah.
Now, okay, sir.
Okay. So, third variety of Abhishangaja Jwara, that is called Visha Abhishangaja Jwara, where the Visha or the poisonous things are afflicted to the body, like Visha Vraksha Anila Sparshat, when body is connected with the poisonous air, or that is Vraksha, Visha Vraksha Anila Sparshat, that is Visha Vraksha Sparshat or Visha Anila Sparshat, तथा अन्यैः विषसंभवैः और एनी अदर टाइप ऑफ पॉइजन देन दैट इज कॉल्ड विषाभिषंगज ज्वर अभिषक्तस्य चापि आहुः ज्वरमेके अभिषंगजम। हियर ज्वरम एके अभिषंगज मीन्स एके मीन्स अकॉर्डिंग टू सम, इट इज नॉट लाइक इट इज एक्सेप्टेड बाय द ऑथर ऑफ चरक संहिता, इट इज कॉल्ड एकीय सूत्र इन सुश्रुत संहिता। एके मीन्स somebody will consider this also, that is the method of understanding samhitas. So here Vishabhishangaja Jwara, it's also a type of jwara or a vyadi which is produced due to the poison. Then how to treat those things, that is the context, or that is the thing which we have to see in the clinical practice. It says Vishabhishangaja Jwara chikitsaya vishagneiva sa shamam labate naraha. So if it is Vishabhishangaja Jwara, if you diagnose this it as a cause or a disease produced due to Visha, then it is treated with the Visha also, that is Vishagna Chikitsa should be followed, then Vishabhishangaja Jwara will be subsided. Then the first two causes, so we have discussed the last two causes, that is Abhigata and Abhishanga. And the first two, Abhichara and Abhishapa, they are discussed in the end, because the intensity or the severity of Abhichara and Abhishapa, it's too serious or too heavy. That's why it is explained in the end. So that is called Pratiloma Tantra Yukti. In the list of Chaturvidha cause, here it is mentioned Abhigata, Abhishanga, Abhichara and Abhichapata. And in the same context, here it is mentioned, that is Abhichara and Abhishapa. Abhichara himsartu atharva mantra homadi. What is Abhichara? It is like using Atharva Veda mantra, the mantras of Atharva Veda, it is chanted and some sacrifice is performed just to cause problem to others. That is himsartha. That is himsartha means you are disturbing the other's energy, positive energy, that is called himsartha. So anybody who is disturbing other person with the help of chanting of Atharva Veda mantra and performing the yajna or homa as told in the text of Atharva Veda, then that is called abhichara. And who will do that? You may ask, who will do this? That is siddha nam yaha pravartate. There are some person who are expert in understanding these mantras, and there are some person who are expert in understanding or performing these homas, and they are having some form of the powers in the form of tapa shamadhi siddhaha, like they are doing some tapas or meditation, and the power which is so immense they are utilizing for disturbing others, that is called abhichara. That is siddha nam yaha pravartate. There are some experts who are doing this abhichara. And what is siddha? As told by Chakrapani, is siddha mantra aushada tapashyamadi siddhaha. They know certain herbs, that is aushada. They know certain mantras of Atharva Veda, and they are meditating and they are doing this self-control of their senses. And then they acquire some of the special power, and that power is utilized for bad purpose, then that is called abhichara. And in Sushruta Samhita, this is mentioned as a Krutyam. In the Sushruta Samhita Sutrasthana 6th chapter, it is mentioned as Krutya. Krutya is Kupita Mantrino Abhichara Karma Nimita Rakshasi Visheshaha. That is a mantra which is wrongly utilized. That is Kupita Mantrina Abhichara Karma. It is used for negative purpose. And Rakshasi Visheshaha. Rakshasi Vishesha means an evil spirit is invited and that is sent for injuring or harming others. That is called Kratyam. That means they catch hold of some negative energy which is roaming in crematorium or some other places, and they utilize for some bad purpose. They cause or they get some negative energy from those Rakshasi Vishesha, and that is used for harming others. That is called Kritya. In Sushruta Samhita, the word Kritya is mentioned, and in Charaka also, the word Kritya is mentioned. So Abhichara and Kritya are more or less similar, but in Kritya, negative energy is always utilized for certain purposes, for doing bad things to the others. Whereas Abhichara, it is the mantra and homa for different purposes. Different Atharva mantra and different homas are utilized, and then the purpose will be obtained. So that is the difference between Abhichara and Kritya. The place where I am practicing in the coastal belt of Karnataka, you can see these type of occult practice or the practice in the form of inducing negative energy. And nobody will come forward saying that I am doing Abhichara or I am doing Kritya. But people or the patient, when we interrogate with them, they say, we have some negative energy which is induced by someone. We have seen certain things right in front of our house on particular day. And after that, we have some negative energy and we have some disorders. Or sometimes they say, we have seen certain things in other places where I'm working. And then I got this particular incident or I got certain accident. So that is the thing which you can interrogate with the patient. So it's the Abhichara or Kritya. It is still in practice in the most of the places of India, where a person who is expert in inducing negative energy will induce negative energy, and thereby diseases is produced or diseases are induced to a person. So that is called Abhicharam. And Abhishapa means it is the cursing, the curse by a certain person. Then you may get a disorder that is called Abhishapa Janita Vyadhi. And when you see the Vedic astrology, when certain things are asked about the family thing in astrology, they say Abhishapa is one of the main cause for getting negative energy and disorder. That is, a family member is cursing some other family, then that energy will be continued for generation to generation, and that is causing negative energy and disorder. So Abhichara and Abhishapa are considered as the two important aspects of Agantu Vyadhi. Then you may ask, how to understand or how we can understand there is Abhichara or there is Abhishapa. Here in the coastal belt of Karnataka and Udupi, the people are getting the help of Vedic astrology to see whether they are having some negative energy from others. Usually, an expert Vedic astrologer can tell you that you are having the problem of Abhichara or Abhishapa based on the calculations. Or the other method which is told in the Charaka Samhita is you have to depend upon a person who is considered as a person who got Ashta Siddhi or Ashta Aishwarya. So if a person who is having the knowledge of Ashta Siddhi or Ashta Aishwarya, then the identification of Abhishapa and Abhichara is very easy. And what are the Ashta Siddhi as told in the Charaka Sharira first chapter or Kathida Purushiya Adhyaya? The first one is Avesha. I hope all of you have heard about Avadhuta or Avadhut. So Avadhuta, usually they have the Siddhi, which is considered as Ashta Siddhi. At least one or two Siddhi usually they have, and they can see the things of past, future and present. So that is the beauty of attaining Ashta Siddhi. So first Siddhi is Avesha. Avesha means para pura pravesha. The person can enter into other's body. That is para pura pravesha. That's what in Charaka Vimanasthana third chapter he says, Aturasya antaratmanam gatva. That is, you have to enter into soul of another person. So that is a form of avesha. Then chetaso jnanam. That is parachitta jnanam. If you can read the mind of other who is sitting in front of you, then called chetaso jnana. I know there are certain personalities in this particular area of coastal belt of Karnataka. They can read the mind of others. That is called chetaso jnanam. Then arthanam chandatah kriya. That is, they can utilize their sense organs whenever it is required, or as per their wish, they use their panche indriyartha. That is arthanam chandatah kriya, or arthanam icchatah karanam. If they want to see, even during night, they can see the things. Even if they are closing their eyes, they can see. So that is called arthanam chandatah kriya. Then drushtihi, that is atindriya darshanam. What is called ESP, extra sensory perception. That is seeing which the other person or other people cannot see. That is called atindriya darshanam, or extra sensory perception. There are few people in this particular place who can see the atindriya, or the things beyond our sensory perception. That is called drushtihi or atindriya darshanam. And even they say, I can see some Pishachi is moving around you. And sometime they say some Brahma Rakshasa is inside your body. So that is called drushtihi or atindriya darshanam. There are few people here where usually I discuss this bhuta vidya with them. And shrotram. Shrotram means atindriya shravanam. That is, they hear the sounds or voices which others cannot hear. That is called shrotram or atindriya shravanam, or extra sensory perception in the form of hearing. I know few people of this particular place who can hear certain sentences told by amanusha or some form of spirit. Usually they tell astrology based on this atindriya shravanam. If you ask something in the form of when I'll get married, they give a pause of 10 or 15 seconds. They hear something which is told by some amanusha shakti, and then they reply, you will be getting married within 1 year. So that sentence, it is told by some amanusha shakti, and same thing will be repeated by that particular person. So that is called shrotram. I know there was a person here who was having atindriya shravanam. Now he is no more. He was a liar. And whenever you ask something, he used to give pause of 5 to 10 seconds to hear that atindriya shravanam, and then same thing will be told you. So that is shrotram. Then smritihi. Smritihi means sarva bhava tattva smaranam. Thinking that nothing is permanent in this world, such things are called smritihi. Then kantihi, with some abnormal or increased luster, or amanushi kanti, that is also a form of siddhi. Then ishtatascha adarshanam. They can appear at any time, anywhere, or they can disappear from a place. That is called ishtatascha adarshanam. So if you have a person who is having the knowledge of all these 8 siddhis, or at least one or two siddhis, then you can be a better student of bhuta vidya. So you may ask, how I have entered into this particular bhuta vidya is, I got some connection with a few people who are having more than one or two siddhis. They are not revealing that I have these siddhis, but when you observe them for a period of at least 1 month or so, you will understand this is not considered, or this person is beyond our normal assumption. So that is because of siddhi. It may be in the form of parachitta jnanam, or it may be in the form of atindriya darshanam, or it may be in the form of atindriya shrotram, or it may be in the form of parapura pravesha, etc. I know a person in Kerala who used to do parapura pravesha, or entering into others' body. He is a master in marma chikitsa. Whenever the body requires that his soul should enter into others' body, then he used to do that avesha. I have seen a few occasions he is doing so. I'm not explaining everything here, but there are some people who used to do these things. So siddhi, it is essential for understanding bhuta vidya. Otherwise, we will simply arguing the things like how it is possible, how pishachagraha can be seen, or how pishachagraha should be understood, or what is the logic of giving so many bali or dupa to this particular graha, or how nagagraha can be understood, or any other grahas, how balagrahas are explained in the text, and how we can understand. It all depends upon the understanding by a person who is considered as a siddha, or who have attained siddhi. And moreover, along with the knowledge of the siddha purushas, I have made an instrument which is available in the market, which is known as geopathic stress scanner or aura scanner, which always read about positive energy and negative energy if you purchase from the market. But with the knowledge of the Ayurveda in the form of Charaka Samhita, Sushila Samhita, and Ashtanga Hridaya, I made that instrument to read the things which are explained in the text. Suppose if I want to know if a person is having Bhuta Abhishanga, I can identify with that particular instrument that will be showed in the end of this particular class. So I utilize this as a supportive to understanding the grahas along with the knowledge of the Siddha Purushas. So this is very important. Otherwise, whenever you read Bhuton Mada, or when you are reading Amanush Upasarga, or whenever you are reading Balagraha, you feel that this is totally nonsense. Because of the limitation of our indriyas, or because of the limitation of our energy, positive energy, we cannot see the things which are considered as extra sensory thing. So it is not possible for us to understand those things. But when you depend, or when you see a person who is having extra sensory perception, then you feel that those things are existing in the society. And then Charaka says about Ashta Siddhi, then how you can attain these things, or is it possible to get these things from you? It is also explained, yes, when the Rajas and Tamogunas are totally absent and Sattvaguna is increased, then you get these Ashta Siddhi or Ashta Aishwarya. So our aim is to get a reduction of Rajoguna and Tamoguna, and to increase Sattvaguna in the body. Then you will get the Ashta Siddhi. Then the concepts of Bhuta Vidya, or concepts which are explained in the text, can be better understood. Then iti, while telling about Ashta Siddhi, it says iti ashtavidam akhyatam. Thus there are 8 types of Ashta Siddhi. Yoginam balamaishwaram. It is considered as strength and the wealth of a yogi. I don't explain who is yogi and all. I hope all of you know about a yogi. Then shuddha sattva samadhana. It happened, or it is possible only you have shuddha sattva, or sattva guna is in a clear state. Then rajoguna and tamoguna are reduced. Tat sarvam upajayate. Then anything or all is possible. So that is the idea of diagnosis of bhuta vidya. Usually, when I talk with, or when I talk about Bhuta Vidya, people ask, is it relevant to the present context? The answer is yes, it is relevant even today. But the relevancy comes whenever there is the presence or identification of positive factors. And as we have limitation of our knowledge, we should depend upon the person like Siddha to understand these things. And when you get a teaching from a people like Avadhutas or Siddha, then you will have better knowledge of these Agantu factors. So you should try to get those things not from only Ayurveda, it is from other ancient literatures or other ancient sciences of India. And the intensity, I told the Abhichara and Abhishapa, it's so heavy or so serious. That is Abhichara Abhishapa Abhyam Siddhanam Yaha Pravartate Sannipata Jaro Ghoraha Sa Vijneyaha Sudustahaha. If there is Abhichara, then the Jwara or any other disorder, it is very serious and Dussahaha. Dussaha means it is very difficult to treat. And Ghoraha means it is serious or severe form. Similarly, Abhishapa, if you have curse which is running in the family, then it is also very serious and it is very difficult to treat. And what are the lakshanas of Abhichara and Abhishapa? It is Sannipata Jwarasya Uktam Lingam Smritam. That is the features of Sannipata Jwara. There are 15 types of Sannipata Jwara, which are explained in Charaka Samhita. And in all the Sannipata Jwara, there is Chitta Vibhrama or disturbance of the mind. Then Indriya Dushti or sensory organs are disturbed. And Shariranam, that is the body is also disturbed. Arthaya means pain, the pain related to mind, pain related to indriyas and pain related to body. And if you see the definition of Jwara, which is explained in the beginning of Jwara Chikitsa of Charaka Samhita, it says, Deha Indriya Manastapi Sarva Roga Grajobali. The Jwara is considered as an important disorder when compared to all other disorders. And there will be Tapa of Deha, Tapa of Indriya and Tapa of Manaha. Or that is called Manastapa, Indriya Tapa and Deha Tapa. In clinical practice, we are giving maximum importance to the increased body temperature or Deha Tapa and what is Indriya Tapa and what is Manastapa or what is Manasa Jwara, which is explained in Charaka Samhita. We are not giving much importance. If you see Charaka Samhita, if you open and read Charaka Samhita, there is a version of Manasa Jwara or Manastapa is also explained. And if you see the symptoms, it is more or less like the Manoroga. So it is not only Jwara means it is not only the increased body temperature, it is the increased body temperature or it is the Manastapa or Indriya Tapa. So if you understand in this way, you will get certain patients who are diagnosed as PUO or FUO, pyrexia of unknown origin or fever of unknown origin. Usually, if you practice for 10 years, definitely you will get at least 10 or 15 patients coming with the diagnosis of PUO or FUO. They say, I have taken the modern medicine, I have admitted in modern hospital, and they diagnosed it as PUO or FUO. Pyrexia of unknown origin or fever of unknown origin. What does it mean? Because if you see Ayurvedic perspective also, you will get the disorder or jwara of Sannipata in nature, and the causative factors are not so easy to detect, and then probably it will be so here jwara means it is not only the increased body temperature, it is manastapa and indriya tapa also. So with this what Charaka says, chitta indriya shariranam artayo anyacha na ekashaha. Anyacha na ekashaha means it is the different varieties of chitta tapa, different varieties of indriya tapa or indriya arti, or different varieties of Shariranam Artihi. Or you can understand or understood in this way, that is the symptoms are fluctuating. Sometime you will have the Indriya Tapa, sometime the person is exhibiting Sharira Tapa, and sometime in the form of Chitta Tapa. So it is the fluctuation of the symptoms, or the Sannipata Jwara Akriti or changing every time. I have explained a rati or a person suffering from sannipata jwara in the previous class. Similarly, the person is going to change the presentation quite often. So that is chitta indriya shariranam artayo anyaha cha na ekashah or anekashah. Many varieties of pain or tapa will be observed in the patient. Then Charaka says, how you have to diagnose abhichara jajwara or abhishapa jajwara or any disorder produced due to abhichara and abhishapa, says drishtva. Here drishtva means it is not like seeing with the naked eyes. As I told, you have to get the support of any avaduta or siddha who can see the past, present and future. He should see the things, what is happened, what has happened and what is the management. Then swayam shrutva, or you have to hear what are the things which were happened or which were there in the patient's body. Then anumanena lakshati, then anumana pramana should be utilized. Then prashama, prashamena lakshati, then you have to give medicine, and if he is responding to the treatment, then you should understand this is abhicharika and this is abhishapaja. So that's how you have to do the diagnosis. But in clinical practice, it's not so easy, because every time, depending upon a person who is having Ashta Siddhi or Ashta Aishwarya, it's not so easy. That's why I'm using that instrument which can read these Agantu factors that will be explained later. And what is the severity of this particular abhichara and abhishapa is, it is vaividhyat, abhicharasya abhishapasya vaividhyat. Vaividhyat means it is of innumerable number. If you go around India, you can see n number of the abhicharika kriya and even abhishapa, it is innumerable in number. And according to the act done by the person, or according to the act done by the siddha, lakshanam pratakvidam syad, there will be change in the symptoms exhibited by the patient. So it all depends upon the method of abhichara application, or it all depends upon the act of abhishapa, and accordingly the person is showing the symptom. So to understand what is abhichara and abhishapa, you should know certain things which are there in the ancient India in the form of mantra, tantra and yantra. You have to read the books related to these in the form of reading the Vedas and reading various tantra shastras. Then you will understand what are the different techniques to induce negative energy. Of course, these can be used for positive energy also, that's different. But how in ancient India and even today, the mantras, tantras and yantras are utilized for inducing negative energy, and that is used for creating negative energy in the person's body. So it's not only Ayurveda which you should study. It requires a study of a lot more things, like understanding the Veda concepts, understanding the tantric rituals and a few more things, even the Vedic astrology and so on. So it's like Paratantra Avalokana, which is told by Sushruta Samhita. It is very important to understand the Agantu factors. And when I say these things, you may feel that it's not possible for us to understand these things. It's not so easy, but it's not impossible. If you have dedication, then you can understand these things and you can practice it to some extent. What are the Daiva Pashya Chikitsa which we can use in the clinical practice, that will be told in the next class. So these are some of the concepts behind understanding Daiva Pashya Chikitsa and Agantu factors. How these things are linked together, that will be explained today. And if you see the treatment of abhichara and abhishapa and bhuta abhishanga, he says in Charak Samhita Chikitsa Sthana, that is shapa abhicharat bhutanam abhishangat yo jwarah daiva vipashrayam tat sarvam aushadam ishyate. If a person is suffering from a vyadhi or jara, which is produced due to abhishapa or abhichara or bhuta abhishanga jwara or vyadhi, then daiva vipashrayam tat sarvam aushadam ishyati. It is, it can be cured with daiva vipashraya chikitsa. So only daiva vipashraya chikitsa is applicable here, no yukti vipashraya chikitsa. And if you see the treatment of vishama jwara in charaka samhita, where the jwara is seen in various dhatus, and the presentation of jwara is like santataka, satataka, anya dushika, tritiyaka, etc. And agantu factor is definitely present as told by charaka. And in vishama jwara, he, along with the yukti vipashraya chikitsa, he has explained some of the dhupa chikitsa also. So such things will be explained in the next class. But agantu factor, usually it responds very well for daiva vipashraya chikitsa. But the problem of application of daiva vipashraya chikitsa is certain patients, before coming to your clinic, they have performed almost all daiva vipashraya chikitsa as told by Vedic astrologers, and they lost faith in daiva vipashraya chikitsa. Then you cannot perform daiva vipashraya chikitsa to a fuller extent. That is a problem in application of daiva vipashraya chikitsa that will be explained in the further case. So this is how agantu vyadhi, it is directly connected with the daiva vipashraya chikitsa. It is not yukti vipashraya chikitsa which is so important in agantu factors. If you have diagnosed a disease as a causative factor as agantu, then daiva vipashraya chikitsa works very well. That I have seen in the clinical practice. But you should be able to decide it, whether it is only agantu or it is associated with nija vyadhi also. We will discuss a case, a short case discussion with the same context. We will call that person or a boy, SH. He is a male, aged about 21 years. He is suffering from pain in the different joints, that is multiple joint pain, and low back ache, sometime even upper back ache, and extreme tiredness since 10 years. He came recently, last year, he visited my clinic, and it was diagnosed as Vata Vyadhi in the beginning, 10 years ago, and they have treated the treatment, or they have followed the treatment of Vata Vyadhi in the form of Bahya Snehana, Abhyantara Snehana, Bahya Sveda, and many oral medications, Rasyastra preparation. It is this particular person, he has treated with more than 10 Ayurvedic doctors, and he has consulted more than 15 modern practitioners or allopathic practitioners. Even he admitted in the modern hospital and Ayurvedic hospital as well. And he didn't get much relief, even though he is visiting many doctors quite often. And when he visited me, he told only this much, that is multiple joint pain, pain in the low back, and severe tiredness. And when I asked certain features after touching his body, the body was somewhat like hot when compared to normal human body. Then I asked, did you have fever? He told no, but I am feeling some feverish sometime. Then I asked these questions, like adhika trishna, that is increased thirst, he said yes, and shvasanam, that is sometime on and off, he is feeling difficulty to breathe, that is shvasanam, it was there. Then when there was difficulty to breathing, then there was, it is associated with the giddiness, and sandhi and astishula, it was there, and absence of sweating, that was there, and constipation, that is varchaha apravartanam. Then I diagnosed it as antarvega jwarasya lakshanani. So the symptoms he told as symptoms or the clinical features of Vata Vyadhi, and I diagnosed it as antarvega jwara lakshanam. You see the lakshanas which are explained in Charaka Samhita, that is antarvega, adhika trishna, pralapaha, shasanam brahmaha, sandhyasthi shulam, asvedu, doshavarchan, doshavarcha, apravartanam. So it is antarvega jwarasya lakshanani, and based on these features, I have administered certain decoctions. Those things I have not explained here, what are the things I have explained. And for a few days, he got relief, and with some form of satisfaction, he came back and took medicine. And after 1 month, he came up with the other symptoms, like the symptoms like the periodical fever. That is, there is continuous fever for few days, and then fever or feeling of fever once in 3 days or once in 4 days. Then that is the feature of Vishamajwara Lakshana. Then I thought probably this could be Vishamajwara. Then I selected some of the drugs which are explained in Charaka Samhita in the context of Vishamajwara Kvatahara or Vishamajwara Harakvata. And it is administered. Again, for a month, he was all right. And then he came up with certain other features like repetition of fever. And then again, I saw the symptoms like feeling of depression or dinata and paleness over the body parts or panduta and not at all feeling interest to take food or na anna kamata. Then I diagnosed it as Punaravartaka Jwara and Punaravartaka Jwara Hara Kashaya as explained in Charaka Samhita. It was administered and the result is same. He showed maximum response to 15 days to 1 month. Then again, he came up with certain other features, like telling that the disease is like that, previous like that only. That is the joint pain or pain in the all the joints and backache and all the reports which are done earlier, they are normal. They are not showing any features of rheumatic fever or rheumatoid arthritis or any other thing which is connected to the diagnosis of fever. So even though the every report is normal, he is exhibiting the symptoms of multiple joint pain. And when it is asked, it is associated with the fever or what we call it is in the form of Vishamajwara or Punaravartaka Jwara or Antarvega Jwara. Then I thought, what is the vikara prakriti and adhisthana samuttana? Every time it is assessed and yukti vapashri chikitsa is done and there was no improvement. Then I asked him about whether he has taken some devi vapashri chikitsa or whether he consulted some jyotisha or jyotishi for understanding his problem. He said yes, he consulted more than 5 to 6 astrologers or Vedic astrologers, and they have advised him to perform so many pujas. They have advised him to perform certain vratas. They have advised him to visit few temples. And he did all those things which are told or informed by the astrologers. Then also there was no improvement. That means he is a patient who is not responding to your yukti vapashri chikitsa, and he is not responding to your daiva vapashri chikitsa. Even the sattva of this particular patient, it's not heena sattva. He is having good sattva. It is not like a heena sattva purusha is susceptible for various disorders. He is not having any heena sattva. He is having good sattva, but he is suffering from a disease since last 10 years. Then I thought in a different perspective, which is explained in Sushruta Samhita, where the vyadi sambhava hetu, or the causative factors which are explained for a disorder in a different way. It is explained in Charaka Sushruta Samhita 6th chapter, 19th shloka, which says the first causative factor for manifestation of a disease is krutyam. Krutya is kupita mantrino avichara karma janita rakshasi vishesha. That already it is explained. A form of inducing negative energy by a person who is expert in that. Then abhishapa, it is also explained. Raksha krodha, that is in the form of amanusha upasarga, that is also explained. Then visha aushada pushpa gandhena vayuna. If something in the form of the visha abhishanga, if it is there, then the person is susceptible for disorder. Then graha nakshatra charitaiva, according to your horoscope, if your time is not so good in the form of the momentary or the moment of various graha and planets, then you will be having a disorder. Like in Sushruta Samhita, it is mentioned, chaneshcharadinam, if you are having some problem in the form of Shani or Rahu or Ketu, then you will be having disorder. That is Graha Nakshatra Charitaiva. That is also enquired. He said, as per astrologer, his time is very good at present. So that is Graha Nakshatra Charita, cause is not there. Then Graha Garihita Lakshana Nimitta. When you exclude all these causative factors or Nimitta, like Kratya, Abhisha, Paraksha, Visha, and Graha Nakshatra Charitaiva, then the causative factor which is present or which is remaining is the concepts of Vastu Vidya. Here, one thing I wanted to make clear, the word meaning of Vastu, it is derived from word Vastu. That means the Vastu means it is the place of residence or place you are residing, that is called Vastu. And even the if it is a flat or apartment, then your house is considered as Vastu. That is second meaning. Third meaning is the things which you are keeping or which you have kept inside your home, then that is also called Vastu. That is Vastuna Bhavam Vastu. Suppose you have a thing which is exhibiting or which is emitting negative energy, if it is present inside your home, then that is considered as causative factor for disorder. So in that way, I'll try to see whether this person is having something in the form of negative energy in the form of Vastu. That is, first one is Graha Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. If a house is not built according to Vastu Shastra, or if house is showing some form of negative energy, then that is called Graha Garhita Lakshana Nimitta, Vyadi Pradurbhavaha. Then Dara Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. Some patient will say, after marriage, they are showing some form of ill health. That is because of mismatching with the energy of wife. Dara means here Bharya or wife. Even for wife, it is the energy of husband. That is husband and wife energy. It is a combined energy. If it is in the form of positive energy, then only the health will be maintained. If there is negative energy, then that is considered as a Dara Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. And if it is there, the person will have disorder or some form of accidents or some of form of serious illness immediately after marriage. So that is called Dara Garhita Lakshana Nimitta Vyadi Pradurbhavaha. And the list continues. It is there in the Sushila Samhita. You just read. Another varieties or another concept or positive factor is Shayana Nimitta, Shayana Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. If the cot or Shayana, which you are using for sleeping purpose, if it is improper, if it is having only 3 legs or 3.5 legs, or which is shaky, or which is not having improper thing, or certain things are there along with the bed, then that is called Shayana Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. Then Asana Garhita Lakshana Nimitta, the chair which you are using for sitting purpose, if it is having negative energy, then that is called Asana Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. Then the vehicles, that is Yana Vahana Lakshana Nimitta Vyadi Pradurbhavaha. Your vehicle which is having negative energy, then you may get the disorder or you may get some accident. So that is the another cause. Then Mani Ratna Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. Almost 90% of the precious stones available in the market today, they are artificially prepared. And when you wear certain precious stones, then it will impart or it will create negative energy in your body and disease may be produced. So these are the things which are connected to Vastu Vidya. It is not only the Vastu in the form of house and place of residence, any other objects in the form of Shayana, Asana, Yana, Maniratna, Dara, all these things are connected to Vastu Vidya only. So usually I see these things. And the last thing which you have to see in Vastu is Upakarana Garhita Lakshana Nimitta. Upakarana means all the things which you are keeping inside your house. If it is distorted, if it is not proper, if it is broken, and many things, like here in the place where I'm living here, the old people used to say, if there is a mirror and if it is broken, then you should not keep the broken mirror inside your house, or you should not see your image in the broken mirror. It is based on this Upakarana Garita Lakshana Nimitta Vyadi Pradurbhava. Every time when you see this broken mirror, your energy will be disturbed. You will have negative energy. Similarly, any other object inside your home which is having negative energy, and that will cause Vyadhi in the people who are residing there. So usually I see these things whenever there is nothing is obvious as a causative factor for disorder. I use these things in the form of Graha Garita Lakshana Nimitta. Then the total energy of that particular house will be disturbed. So with the aura scanner, I used to see whether that particular house is having a positive energy or a negative energy. And for this particular patient, SH, I saw, and it shows some form of negative energy in the form of Vastu Shastra. Usually, if a person sitting in front of me, then I can see whether his Vastu is proper or not. Then I told, probably you have the negative energy which is coming from the place of residence. Every time your Vyadhi is responding to some form of Chikitsa, and again, that will come back form of usual pattern of disease. So it all happened because of a geopathic stress scanner or geopathic stress. In short, what is geopathic stress? You just go through Google. You will have thousands of pages about geopathic stress. What is geopathic stress and how it can be detected? Geopathic stress is nothing but the energy of the earth. We are residing on the surface of earth, and inside the earth, there will be some form of negative energy, not always. In some areas, we have some form of the hard stones or some form of underwater current or some form of negative energy which was flowing from one place to another place. And if there is such form of negative energy inside the earth, that will be exhibited or that will be seen on the surface of that particular place also. And when you are residing right in that particular place, you will be having that negative energy of the earth, and that is known as a geopathic stress. And for that purpose, in places like USA and other areas or other nations, they use geopathic stress scanner to see whether the earth is having positive energy or negative energy. And usually I use this for getting the knowledge of the energy of the earth as well as energy of a person, that is Deshastu Bhumihi Aturascha. We have a concept. Desha means it is Bhumi Desha and Atura Desha. I use that particular instrument for understanding Bhumi Desha or understanding the geopathic stress of that particular place, and Atura Desha also. What are the Aguntu factors which are acting on this particular person, whether it is Abhishapa, Abhichara, Abhishapa, etc. Then I'll see accordingly and I'll treat accordingly. Usually, if there is Agantu factor, I am not explaining everything to the patient because there is every chance of that patient may get afraid by your words. That's why usually I don't tell everything, but I say you have negative energy and with the medicines, you will be getting positive energy. And the reference which is told in Sushruta Samhita about Bhumi Pariksha, though it is not directly related to Vyadhi, for Aushadha, for getting good plants or a plant with good energy, the place should be, it should not be destroyed by Valmika. That is, Valmika means anthill. Imagine there is a place where the anthill is present. And if it is destroyed, then there will be formation of negative energy. That is known as Valmika Upahata Bhumi. And to get the plants, it should not be Valmika Upahata Bhumi. Similarly, the plant should not be collected by or collected from Smashana or crematorium. That is Smashana Anupahata Bhumi. during near crematorium and inside the crematorium, usually you have maximum amount of negative energy that I have seen in many crematoriums. Or if a person is residing near crematorium in an area of 1.5 kilometer, that negative energy can be seen with that particular instrument. That is called Smashana Anupahata Bhumi. Then Aghatana Anupahata Bhumi. If there is slaughterhouse where the animals are killed, then that is also causing negative energy. And if a person is residing near Aghatana Bhumi, then that is causing some form of health disturbances. That is Aghatana Upahata Bhumi. Then Devatayatana Upahata Bhumi, or land should be collected where the temple is not destroyed. That is the meaning which is explained here. And if you take the opposite meaning, plant should be collected in a place with a good positive energy. Here, Devatayatana Anupahata Bhumi means the temple with the positive energy should be there to get proper strength or proper energy in a human body. If the temple is destroyed or the person is residing right directly on a place where there was temple previously, then that is also causing negative energy. And that is what Devatayatana Upahata Bhumi. And this particular patient, SH, he is residing in a place which is known as Devatayatana Upahata Bhumi. You may ask one question, how this diagnosis is made? One thing, based on geopathic stress scanner, I diagnosed that he is residing in a place where maximum amount of negative energy is present. Then, with the help of a person who is known as a Avadhuta, or in the form of a person who can see the things in the form of Drishtva, I asked him to see. When he saw that particular patient, he said, the place of residence of this particular patient, it belongs to temple previously. That is nothing but Devatayatana Upahata Bhumi. Whenever you are residing on a place where there was temple previously, then you will be having maximum negative energy and you will be suffering a lot. And this has been seen in so many patients. And whatever medicine you give and whatever the plan or treatment plan you decide or you think, and whatever the time you give to the patient, they are not responding so easily to your treatment, because whatever your treatment is in the form of Deyopashraya, Yuktiyopashraya or Sattvavajaya, they are not responding to any of these treatments. And then you should consider the place of residence, because on an average, every person will sleep around 5 to 6 hours in a place at home. That means 6 hours of negative energy will come to that particular person. That's why the place of residence is so important to understand whether a person is getting positive energy or negative energy in the form of geopathic stress. So this particular patient, he has seen that he is residing right over a temple which was present. That is temple of Lord Ishvara or Lord Shiva, which was there earlier. And this poor man, he is not knowing, or he is not aware of the thing which was there earlier. It is not like a recently demolished temple which was present there. It was long back, around 300 years ago. There was a temple and it was totally destroyed. And over that particular place, he constructed a vastu or a graha, and it is having negative energy. And then what is the treatment when you ask that? Now, since last few months, I'm going to that particular place and I'm modifying the negative energy with the help of Vraksha Ayurveda. What is Vraksha Ayurveda? It is a part of Ayurveda, which is explained by Surapala, a small book which explains about the connection between human body energy with the plants. He explains what are the good plants you have to put around your house. What are the negative, what are the plants you should not put around your house, which are creating negative energy. With that particular idea, I usually advise certain plants around the house based on the amount of negative energy and form of negative energy. And I'm doing that. And till now, only some 20% of the result he is getting. It's not complete in the form of a complete treatment. Meanwhile, that particular person who can see the things of like a Devatayatana Upahata Bhumi, he is also doing some Deva Pashari Chikitsa along with me. And we are expecting some positive result. And he will be free from the disorder in the form of pain in the multiple joints, low back ache, and tiredness. And we will hope for the best. It's not so easy that whatever we have studied will come to use. So this is one such patient. It's like whatever you think, he is not responding to those particular aspects. So this is how you have to understand the Agantuk factors and how we have to do Daiva Pashra Chikitsa. And what are the Daiva Pashra Chikitsa I utilize in the clinical practice that we can be explained in the next class. Otherwise, you give me some form of questions so that I'll be preparing for the last class of this particular series so that your ideas will be cleared. With this, I'll conclude my talk about the role of Daiva Pashra Chikitsa in Agantuk Vyadhi. If you have any doubts, then you can ask.
So, thank you, sir. I think that very very nicely presented lecture. If you have any question, you can ask. I think that Dr. Prabhakar Rao, sir, welcome, sir. You are also present in this webinar. I welcome to you also. अगर आपके मन में कोई प्रश्न है तो आप हैंड रेज करिए ना, मैं आपको इधर अनम्यूट करूंगा. सर, आप कुछ बताना चाहेंगे राघवेंद्र उडुपा सर के लेक्चर पे, कोई कमेंट देना चाहें? जी अरविंद सक्सेना जी, आप पूछिए अपना सवाल.
मैं सर, आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन सर, कि इफ द पेशेंट कम्स फॉर द कंप्लेन ऑफ तारा ग्रह, as you mentioned, it's a not a proper interaction between wife and husband, and there are a lot of patient complained about that matter. So, and so how to treat the, that kind of?
Yeah, that's right.
Dr. Sukhsena, you are muted. Yeah. I think that the question what you are asking, I think.
I'll show that instrument. Usually, I follow some of the aspects which are explained in Vastavidya. But usually I use this instrument and I'll show you how it works. It's a very simple thing which is moving as per your energy, and usually the Vastu concepts can be better understood. I'll show you the thing. See, this is how, this is a sensor. I have written here, Bhumi Desha. Can you see or not? I don't know. This is a Bhumi Desha. This sensor, it reads the negative energy if it is present. If it is present, then I can use these things. So this is another sensor. Yeah. So this is the positive energy. I'll put here, and this is also a form of positive energy, which is a special sensor for understanding the Vastu or Bhumi. When I put and when I hold like this, see, this is my horse. So it should move, the both the limbs would move like this. So that means the energy is positive. So I'll show how to handle. See, so this is moving bothward. So this is a positive energy. So this house, it's recently constructed around 4 years ago, based on seeing the presence of positive energy using mud and wood. So this total house, it is constructed only with the mud and wood, no cement or no the iron rods or nothing else, no concrete. So based on that, you can see, so both the limbs are moving. So this is positive energy. That is the Vastu or the energy of this particular house is positive. So this is one aspect. And there are many other aspects like, see either. So this is a sensor of Visha. I have written here. I hope you can see this, that Visha, it's written here. So when I put this particular thing, and if a person sitting in front of me, so this is not applicable to house. So it's like, so it's not there. See, this is only if Visha is there, it's moving both sides. So if a person sitting in front of me, then if I focus like this, if both are moving apart, that means he is suffering from the visha concept. So this is how I make diagnosis.
Okay, I think that आपको आपका answer मिल गया होगा. सर प्रभाकर राव सर आप यहाँ का बहुत बहुत स्वागत है. नमस्कार सर, आप
गुड इवनिंग.
कैमरा ऑन कर लीजिए सर.
सर कैमरा ऑन करूं?
जी सर, अब अच्छा लगेगा सर.
Sir, good evening everybody, and it was wonderful. Dr. Raghavendra ji is giving very nice concepts on this Agantuja and according with this Daiva Vipassana Chikitsa also. It's a very nice presentation. I think there are many references regarding Bhuta. I think there is no much difference in between Bhuta and Graha. Bhutas are, or Grahas are invaded because of three reasons, if I am not wrong. One is for Rati, another one is Abhyardhanam, and third one is Himsa. So these three are, whenever you feel some kind of microbial agents are affected with any human being, because of their replication, Rati, and they wanted to give some kind of illness, that is what you call Himsa, and they wanted to have some kind of Puja, that is what you call Abhyardhanam, Abhyardhanam, what you call. So these three kinds of things which are very, very important factors before invading the organisms into the body. So I would like to have a concept of whenever you have any bhuta invaded in into the human being, how can we identify with this with this instrument?
Yeah, like everything like is not possible. Yeah, everything is not possible to show you, but at least I can show you something like. Here is like I have sensor like Pishacha Adhikrata. Here it's there. I made like it's not like it is available in the market. Based on my knowledge of Samhitas, I add some combination in the form of Jangama Udbida Parthiva Dravyas in this particular sensors, and I use. See, like this is the thing. This is like I have written as Bhuta here. Here it is. Okay. I have written Bhuta. So that means when I focus, this is like when I do like this, I'll take it as this is for Vyadi. I'll keep like this, and I put this Bhuta here. And when I focus, for imagine like there is a person sitting in front of me. Like if I focus like this, if it is present, then it moves apart. Both move, both are moving like this. Both are moving like this. That means he is suffering from
as in case of Visha.
Yeah. Automatically, it's moving like its own way. I'm not doing anything. Just I hold with the constant pressure. That's all. Here it's not there. See, it's not moving both sides. Even for houses also, you can detect it. So I use this technique to understand whether the Bhuta is present or not. If it is there, then which are the grahas like Vishacha Graha, Yaksha? I have certain things like. See, this is like a sensor for Brahma Rakshasa. Like that, every for Pishacha and all, I made this sensor. And I understand this is the thing. Then I ask the symptoms which are explained in the text. For example, if a person is suffering from Pishacha Graha, he is having loss of sleep. He is having some form of tension and some form of Dukkhani Avedayantam. Always he is telling his own problem. So those things, if it is asked, they say, yes, this is there. So that is the that's how you have to match with this textual references and this instrument. So usually approximately 90% it will come true, but there are some patients who are not responding to any of the sensors. That's different, but they'll respond. They'll show the causes.
Can you equate it with the Krimi and Bhuta are the same?
No, it's not possible. No, it's not possible. See,
actually there is one reference that is Bhuta sa Vishak Krimi.
Yeah, it's there.
Bhuta sa Vishakrimi, and those are produces the toxins in the body. They are known as Bhuta.
No, theoretically we can say like whenever I'm giving talk to about Bhuta Vidya, usually I give talk to Bhuta Vidya. They say same thing like the krimis and which are there in the body. Those things they'll explain. But theoretically these things looks fine. I'm not against to that. But in reality, when you practice the things, positive energy and negative energy, the crimis are not coming to the context. They are not crimis, definitely. They are unknown factors. Why it is unknown factor means there are few people who can see these things, these negative energy. They say that is coming from that particular direction and it's going there. And even that instrument also reading in the same way. So it's not the crimi which is moving around the patient's body or person's body. It is definitely not crimi. But in the educational institution, we teach in that way. It's not the right method to understand the Bhuta.
Okay. Anyway, but the thing is whether it is a viremia or bacteremia, any kind of thing, there is a quotation regarding the krimi. Jvaro vivarnata sulam hrudrogam sadhanam brahmaha. Bhakta dvesho ati sarach sanjata krimi lakshana. Jvara is the first and foremost lakshana. So again, if you see all the lakshanas which are related to either viremia or bacteremia, whatever it may be. But can't we consider that these are all bhutas?
No, such things, it is considered by many of the experts previously, and they come with those reports only. It is not like I am the first person to treat those people. So with all the previous assumptions and the treatments, they come with the reports. Usually report doesn't suggest you anything positive in the form of bacteriological findings or virological findings. Usually they don't show.
Okay. Anyway, but we have a drugs like Bhutagna, Vishagna, Pichasagna, Apeta Rakshasi. There are many such drugs are available.
Yeah.
The krimi is not only considered for the parasites, it's considered, it's a broad term, microbials. So in that way, I don't think we can give a scope to that.
That's a different topic. It's a big topic. Definitely, whatever you're telling, it is there, that theory is there. But whatever I am doing in practice, that theory is not giving you much support.
But there are some references, even in case of Atisar also, Jala Viramanair, Vega Vigatai, Krimi Doshata. In that also, we can go for the bacterial and viral, this is what you call waterborne infection.
Yeah.
In that also, we need to study in that way also. And again, in Raja Yakshma also, there is a quotation, Krodho Nisvasa Rupena Murtiman Bhavati. In that case also, there is a bacterial infection with the airborne. So like that, there are many references, but we may not consider at this juncture, but we need to have some study on this.
Yeah, but as per my opinion, like whatever I'm practicing, within area of Bhutavidya, not all, such a theory which whatever you are telling, it is not giving much support to your clinical practice. But for doing a class, it's good. I don't tell it's not a bad thing to think in that way, but in reality it's not giving much help. That's what I'm telling.
Okay, right. We can explore for that also.
Yeah,
okay.
Definitely.
And we can explore. And one more thing is, I think the time is already over. I am taking a little bit.
No, sir. You can, sir. Continue, sir. No problem.
Actually, it is a very interesting topic, and nobody has touched this topic. And Dr. Raghavendra ji is very nicely presented, so that's why it is very interesting to me also. So I am taking a liberty to discuss with that. Okay. Anyway.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Dr. Raghavendra ji.
Yeah.
Yeah. So one more thing I would like to have, we have a lot of steps in Daiva Vipassanaya Chikitsa. Say for example, mantra, aushadha, mani, mangala, bali, upahara, homa, neema, prayachitta, swasthena, tirtha, pranipata, gamadhi. Gamana, adi, bihi. There are some other also, ashtarshaya, tukka also.
Yeah.
So what kind of Daiva Vipassanaya Chikitsa is particularly related? Is there any specificity for that? Say for example, Vishnu Sahasranama in Vishamajwara.
Yeah.
Like that, there are even Graha Chikitsa also, they are giving some kind of mantras.
Okay.
So, but all these, there are, I think, a couple of interventions in Daiva Vipassanaya Chikitsa. Do you have any work of different kinds of Daiva Vipassanaya Chikitsa in different kinds of
Chikitsa? That will be explained in the next week. Definitely, I'll explain.
Okay. We hope this
will be I'll explain.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to discuss with our esteemed speaker. I am very happy. Thank you very much. Dr. Naveen Joshi ji, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your interaction with Professor Ragendra Udupa. And now some questions is there, but I think that what is the effect of the chikitsa in nastik patients, sir? One question is there from Sumanta Senoy.
Yeah, that's what, if he is a nastika, you don't explain these things and don't do that. That's what my sincere request. Because Ayurveda, it depends upon the thing which is known and unknown factors. That's what, pratyaksham, alpam, analpam, pratyaksham, and so. If a person is believing only charvaka darshana, where pratyaksha is only important, that means you cannot do anything for him. You just leave it. Or you just say, I cannot do anything for you. That's your freedom. You can do it. It's not a problem to tell. For few patients, I did it. I tell, like, as per my knowledge and as per my treatment plan, you are not coming in the purview of my treatment plan. So that's why I cannot give you the treatment. You can do it. Otherwise, the simple thing you can tell, for your problem, you should consult a better consultant than me. That's what, with the beautiful words, you can tell, so that he'll go to some other patients. Usually, the person who is suffering from Agantu Vyadi, he is moving from one doctor to another doctor. That is for sure. Whether it is Haryana or Punjab or Kanyakumari or anywhere, they are going from one doctor to another. So that's why you have to tell, look, this Mr. X, this problem seems to me like it's very challenging. And whatever I have studied in Ayurveda, I can't see anything, possibility of giving treatment as per my view, so that you can go and consult some other Ayurvedic practitioners or some modern doctors, so that they will help you. You can tell it. It's not a problem to tell such things. Don't do such a thing like you try to convince him. It's not so easy to convince the people.
Sir, one so word answer. You.
Yes, yes.
One word answer. Nastiko Vajjanam.
That's why it is there in it is there in the Charaka also. Tasmat Nastike Buddhim Jaihiyat. You should be Nastika. Yeah, that's there.
It is told as Pataka also.
Yeah.
Sir, G. Prabhakar Rao, sir, you are beautifully, sir, explaining. I hope that one lecture you are also required in Ayush Darpan platform in some topic.
Sir, we will talk to you later, but please continue with Raghavendra ji.
Yes. I hope that Sunday, the next topic will also, again, the continuation of this series. So, uh-huh. Raghavendra Udupa ji, बहुत अच्छी तरह से यहाँ बहुत नॉर्थ इंडिया के लोग हैं वो कह रहे हैं कि हिंदी में, तो मैं बताना चाहता हूँ कि दिस इज द वेरी न्यू टॉपिक, कोई इस तरह के टॉपिक पर टच नहीं करता है देवपाश्चर्य चिकित्सा, एंड सर हैज वेरी ब्यूटीफुली एक्सप्लेन्ड ऑल दीज थिंग्स, सो आई होप दैट दिस सेशन इज वेरी वेरी नाइस, एंड जी प्रभाकर राव ऑल्सो इंटरेक्टेड विद प्रोफेसर उडुपा, सो आई होप दैट सर अगला लेक्चर कौन सा है जरा आप बता दीजिए, हर बार बताते हैं सर आप, नेक्स्ट व्हाट इज द नेक्स्ट वन,
different forms of Devapasya Chikitsa.
Next Sunday, different forms of Devapasya Chikitsa at the same platform with the same meeting ID and password, 6 p.m. next Sunday. So we all will join again. So thank you, sir, for joining with us. Achha, yahan pe kisi ne kaha hai, Suman Senoy ji keh rahe hain, some sessions on Indriya Sthana also. Okay. We will request, definitely. We will bring some sessions in Indriya Sthana also. So thank you, sir. So very beautifully explained, and I think that 6 baje se leke aap lagatar 1.5 ghanta ho gaya, 1.5-2 ghanta. It's one and more than half an hour. So I hope that, but people are watching in the Facebook as well as in the YouTube. With so many comments are there. So definitely, it's very interesting session in the new topic. Thank you, sir.
Okay. And one more request, if you can forward me the comments and suggestions, that would be...
Yeah, definitely. I will send you the screenshots of those comments to your WhatsApp number. Yeah.
So that I can update for the next class.
Definitely. I will send you all the comments, screenshots to your WhatsApp number. Okay. Thank you.